All right, everybody. So we're going to start the next session, the case presentation and the future case pros. So we have one keynote and seven case presentation. Okay, Zigita, so please start that.
Yeah. Very good morning. It's a pleasure to be back to present choosing the right keratoprosthesis for patient and not the patient for keratoprosthesis. When we talk about the outcomes of keratoprosthesis and chemical injuries or in Stevens-Johnson syndrome, or for that matter, when we try to group patients and try to analyze the outcomes in these groups, at times it does not really give you a very realistic picture, because I'm sure that all keratoprosthesis surgeons here would agree that every patient is so different from the other, and sometimes it does make more justice when you're doing a case-by-case presentation. And what I will be doing here is have a series of case illustrations where we've used different types of keratoprosthesis and the outcomes and what were the factors that led us to actually decide as to whether we would go ahead with the keratoprosthesis at all, and if so, which one. We've heard and spoken about a lot of keratoprosthesis since yesterday. We have the Boston type 1, the Lucia type 1. In India, we also have the Oro keratoprosthesis, which is basically an indigenous make of the Boston type 1 keratoprosthesis. And among the type 2s, we have the OKP, the Lucia type 2, the Boston the Boston type 2, and the osteokeratoprosthesis. And what I've tried to do here is basically try and understand the differences between each of these procedures with respect to the number of stages, the ease of technique, the ease of availability, and the ease of ancillary setup. Procedures such as the OKP definitely require the need for general anesthesia, and sometimes some of our patients were not fit for general anesthesia. We have to resort to other techniques that could be done under local anesthesia. And we have heard to a lot regarding the complications and the outcome in all the previous talks. Our experience so far with the different types of keratoprosthesis is as mentioned here, and the total number of KPROs that we have done so far, including the type 1s and the type 2s, is 190. So this was a lady who presented to us with a chemical injury in 2007, and most of our patients actually have been with us right since the acute injury or the acute stage of the problem for which ultimately a keratoprosthesis was required. This was secondary to domestic violence. Her right eye was thysicle, and this was the left eye at presentation. And what we required to do for her is multiple surgeries to actually first salvage the globe, and then we took her up for the OOKP procedure, which we completed in 2008, and she regained a vision of 624. Close to 6 years down the line, she did have features of laminar resorption and a leak. She developed a retinal detachment, and then we have removed the lamina and then placed a Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis. She continues to maintain a visual acuity of 6x60, but she does have this retroprosthetic membrane that requires to be cut at periodic intervals. Another patient of chemical injury who presented to us in the acute stage, actually with a perforation in the eye, where we've gone ahead and done a Lucia type 1 keratoprosthesis. He presented with a corneal perforation. The other eye had auto-eviscerated, required multiple surgeries to actually form the fornix and to salvage the eye. And ultimately, we went ahead and did the Lucia type 1. It's very important that we understand that there are multiple interventions that might be required in these eyes, both prior to the keratoprosthesis as well as after the keratoprosthesis is done, to maintain the vision that's been achieved once you've done the keratoprosthesis, and to actually have the KPRO in place before you do the KPRO surgery. So this is a list of surgeries that this patient underwent before he actually had the KPRO done. And on the sixth postoperative day, he actually complained of a slight drop in vision. We noticed that there was a retinal detachment, for which we went ahead and did the RD surgery, settled the retina, placed oil in the eye. And within a span of 6 months, the pressure was noted to be high on that side, went in, did a silicone oil removal with Amit glaucoma valve placement. And after that, he had this area of melt, for which we have done a lamellar patch graft here, covered it with the conjunctiva. But like Dr. Bhaskar was mentioning earlier, even when you have a very good conjunctival flap that's covering your carrier graft in the type 1 keratoprosthesis, we've had instances of an absolutely silent melt that occurs beneath, and that's where you need to emphasize the role of ASOCT. And this patient has maintained a visual acuity of 618 over 3 years. Another similar one-eyed patient, the other eye was NPL, following chemical injury, again had a perforation and also had a retinal detachment when he presented to us. This is how the eye looked. And when we took him up for surgery on table, there was this area of thinning that was extending from the medial rectus to the lateral rectus. And there was a retinal detachment inside. So we basically first placed a large lamellar graft beyond which the sclerotomies were made a central full thickness opening, that's the retina and the pupillary plane, placed a temporary keratoprosthesis, and fortunately we were able to settle the retina. The posterior pole was relatively healthy, the disc looked relatively normal, and so this is where we started off with. This is post PK, but we knew that this graft would not survive, and went ahead with a Boston type 1 keratoprosthesis with a visual acuity regained to 20/200 in this patient. All these patients are patients who come back to us for a very regular follow-up, both the earlier one as well as this particular patient. 3 years later, this is how he presented to us in the OPD, despite the fact that we'd actually seen him 3 months earlier, and with an extrusion of the Capro, there was a retroprosthetic membrane, and we had to take him up for a tectonic penetrating keratoplasty and then do a re-Capro, after which his visual acuity is now 2/60. This is the patient that Bhaskar was referring to with the deposits around the tube, and it was the AC tap that revealed the candida. And when we actually went in to replace the keratoprosthesis and do a penetrating keratoplasty, these are these fungal balls that you actually see near the pars plana, which is not visualized when you're doing an indirect ophthalmoscopy in these eyes. And did a therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty, and once the eye quietened down, there was no evidence of infection. We did a re-keratoprosthesis in the patient, and he is maintaining a vision of better than 20/200 now, 2 years following the procedure. We've had a very characteristic set of patients with silicone oil filled eyes, and this was our first patient for whom we did the type 1 keratoprosthesis in 2008, and this is the same eye in 2015. She maintains a vision of 624 now, almost close to 8 years following the Boston keratoprosthesis, and this is one subset of patients where we have noticed that they've had the least problems with the ocular surface. The ones who've maintained a very good graft with no issues related to melt, no issues related to infection. And we always, I keep mentioning about this in multiple talks, but we always keep talking about the role of aqueous in the nourishment and nutrition to the carrier graft. But these are eyes that are oil-filled, hypotonous eyes, where you can't really get rid of the silicone oil, and in most of these instances it's actually the oil that's in contact with the graft, but these are patients who are doing absolutely fine with respect to the graft with no evidence of any melt. So we probably need to really understand what the role of aqueous is in the nutrition of the graft, because this is one subset of patients where we've had really no problems with graft melt. These were the options that we had with us till around 2010, and we felt that there was a need for alternate options with respect to the adnexal status. Sometimes you have patients who have very badly deformed lids, oral issues that prevent us from going ahead with the OOKP, fitness for general anesthesia, and patients where the visual prognosis does not appear to be very good. We needed an alternate option. And this is how we basically looked at having the Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis, which is a modification of the Boston type 2 that protrudes through the oral mucosa. This is one of our patients where we actually went ahead with a primary Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis. This patient was with us right since the acute injury where he presented to us with a perforation. We did the tectonic PK. We advised him for the skin graft, but he went and got it done elsewhere, and he came back to us like this, where we could identify that there was a globe inside, and the ultrasound showed a relatively normal globe on both the sides. The teeth were not very good, mouth opening was a problem, and visual prognosis was a question. So we went ahead and did the Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis for him, and he maintains a visual acuity of 636 now with a follow-up of 2 years. Another patient of chemical injury, in fact, we ourselves had seen him in 2008 with a long-standing nasal retinal detachment, and at that point in time had decided not to do anything. But he came back to us in 2012, had a very brisk PL, and was very keen that something be done. We decided to go ahead with the Boston type 2 keratoprosthesis. Professor Chodosh was with us when we did this surgery. You can see that the significant skin contracture here following surgery, the K-Pro is actually inside here, buried beneath the skin. We decided to open up and do a mucous membrane graft to try and see if we could actually put the mucosa beneath the keratoprosthesis, but that didn't work. And again, scarred down, then we had to revise, do multiple skin grafts here, and here's the keratoprosthesis. And actually this patient got back a vision of 624, and it's now 4 years since the surgery has been done, and he comes back every 6 months. Once a year we need to cut this skin that grows, but that's the least of problems that one could have in any type of keratoprosthesis, whether it is a mucosal overgrowth in the OOKP or the skin growing over in the Boston type 2. So this is one patient who's really doing well following the type 2 keratoprosthesis, the only patient that we have done the type 2 for chemical injury, the remaining being Stevens-Johnson syndrome. This was a patient who actually required a tracheostomy for GA, and he is maintaining a vision of 636 following one episode of sterile vitritis and required the skin overgrowth to be excised. This was a girl of Stevens-Johnson syndrome who could not, who's again unfit for general anesthesia because of her lung condition. And we did the Boston type 2 for her, and she regained a vision of 6.6, then she had a retinal detachment. It is a little difficult to do RD surgeries in an eye with type 2. We again had Professor Chodosh with us when we did the RD surgery for her, and she's maintaining a vision of 636 following the procedure now a year after the RD. Patients of SJS doing well after the procedure with a vision of 618 and 66 at 14 and 12 months following the type 2. Again, in patients who were not fit for general anesthesia or whose teeth were not good enough to do the OOKP. This was an interesting 80-plus-year-old female who's a known patient of OCP. This is how she presented to us, to a colleague of ours, who actually then referred her to us for a keratoprosthesis because this whole eye had gotten conjunctivalized and keratinized. This is how it looked. And she was on systemic immunosuppression. The patient was very active, very keen for visual rehabilitation. She had no teeth that were suitable. She was unfit for GA, and we'd basically planned to do a Boston type 2 keratoprosthesis for her under local anesthesia. And when she came to us just a couple of days before the surgery, I don't have that picture, but to some extent we were able to see her anterior segment details. And we actually decided to decide on table whether we would go ahead with the Boston type 2 keratoprosthesis or actually do a slightly modified limbal allograft for her. And intraoperatively, we noted her cornea to be clear. We did an inferonasal optical iridectomy. Postoperatively, the cornea was relatively clear and epithelized at 1 month. She's still maintaining a relatively clear surface. Her best corrected visual acuity did not improve beyond 3 by 60 because of age-related macular degeneration. I mean, these are some surprises that you tend to see in these patients. Had we gone ahead with a Boston type 2 and she would have recovered a vision of only 3 by 60, probably we would have had an unhappy patient. And this was an outcome that we really did not expect to last, but she is on systemic immunosuppression and she is maintaining a relatively clear corneal surface and she's a year down the procedure. We started the osteokeratoprosthesis. We use the iliac crest. We don't use the tibial keratoprosthesis, the tibial bone more, because our oromaxillofacial surgeon is more comfortable harvesting the iliac crest for his maxillofacial reconstructions. And this was a girl who presented to us. This is how she presented to us, with a brisk PL in both eyes. Her right eye was okay with an axial length of 15 millimeters, and the left eye showed a retinal detachment with an axial length of 14 millimeters, and we were not really sure as to what we should be doing for her. Young girl, and we opened up the left eye, it's a very small cornea, there was severe scarring medially. We used a 6 millimeter trephine and a silicon K-Pro of 6 millimeters. She had a retinal detachment in the left eye, we did the RD surgery. Oil in the eye, the disc was relatively okay, and we covered the eye with a conjunctival flap to cover the graft and then took a mucosa from her lips and put it on the eye. The problems in her was that she had a 6 millimeter graft and the minimum back plate that we have at this point in time is a 7 millimeter. She had scarred lids, so type 1 was not basically an option. She had a small eye, so OOKP, the lamina, is too big to actually place it in this eye, and the type. So finally we decided that we would go ahead with the osteo-K-Pro for her, which has with a 3 millimeter cylinder diameter. And this was the lamina that we prepared. She had this issue with her skin. We'd placed the lamina in the cheek here, but because of her skin having been grafted, there was an exposure, and then we shifted the lamina to another site, following which we took her up for the stage 2 of the procedure. This is the lamina, and the lamina in place, and the same patient actually post-operatively now with a vision of 3 by 60 to 6 by 60. She's able to see objects, people, and she's self-ambulatory. So with a few of these cases that has illustrated the outcome with different types of keratoprosthesis, I would just like to say that yes, one, it's extremely important that we choose patients for keratoprosthesis. None of the patients that come to our clinic are offered keratoprosthesis in the first visit, and we make sure that they are willing for regular follow-ups, they understand what they are getting into, they have realistic expectations with respect to both the visual as well as the cosmetic outcome. And being in India, a country where the climate is tropical, the population is primarily agrarian, and we are worried about fungal infections, we need to take a very balanced decision about the keratoprosthesis itself, as well as the type of keratoprosthesis that we would implant in these patients who otherwise have a very poor prognosis. It's been a very huge learning experience for us with these different types of keratoprosthesis, and we have tried to implement what we have learned from one K-Pro to the other. These are patients who require a lifelong follow-up, and but we do believe that if managed well, the outcomes are good in these patients. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, so are there any questions or comments? We have enough time for an aggressive discussion.
I think I would again like to take this opportunity to ask some questions. But in the OOKP, because we get rid of the iris and the lens, we don't really have a scaffold for RPM. So the incidence of RPM in the OOKP is very less. I would like to know whether we could replicate the same thing with the Boston keratoprosthesis. But having said that, how concerned are you about a single chamber versus a double chamber with the type 1 keratoprosthesis?
Yeah.
We had two very interesting situations with the type 1 keratoprosthesis recently, the one that Bhaskar showed, where there was a melt and I had to replace the keratoprosthesis. He had an intact PC. And intraoperatively, his vitreous was absolutely clear. And I was actually thanking that we had a double chamber in that situation. And the next day, I saw a patient in the clinic, an absolutely clear carrier graft, very quiet on the outside, having signs of vitritis with an intact PC, no signs on the external surface. But when we went in and did a vitreous tap, it turned out to be candida. So I don't know. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Thank you.
Just adding on, just I have one comment to Geeta. You mentioned about the taking the iliac crest for the osteo keratoprosthesis. But in fact, scientifically, it does make a good sense taking the iliac crest, such kind of compact bones, than cancellous bones like tibia, because the rate of resorption may be variable with these two bones, and time will prove.
I don't know. In fact, I was discussing with Maria about it, because we really have done only three cases, and I don't know. I've discussed this with the oromaxillofacial surgeon, if there's any difference between the density of the bone that you actually choose for doing the osteokeratoprosthesis. I don't have an answer to it.
Dr. Temprano, at the Barracair Eye Institute, we are not hospital-based. So the ones who take out the tibia bone are ourselves as ophthalmologists. So we don't have the leisure of having a trauma surgeon or an orthopedic surgeon. I think Dr. Temprano tried taking out iliac crest and other parts of the body, but for us, the easiest bone to take out is the tibial bone. Anatomically, it's easier to access. But if you have your a surgeon, then it's the surgeon's choice. I mean, an orthopedic surgeon.
Okay, so now we're going to move on to the next presentation. The next presentation is provided by Dr. Fukui Minami Aoyama Eye Clinic. So could you start?
Hello, I'd like to talk about novel artificial corneal calcarea keratoprosthesis experiences in four cases with severe corneal disorders. There are two types of corneal transplantation. One is donor cornea, and the other are artificial corneas. And the problems of past corneal transplantation are need for donor cornea, rejection, graft failure, surgical techniques and times, and risk from open sky procedures. The new artificial cornea, keratoprosthesis, was developed to overcome these problems. Here we report the result of keratoprosthesis experiences. This is keratoprosthesis made of acrylic, foldable, injectable, and not requiring open sky. This is the shape of keratoprosthesis. The surgical indication of keratoprosthesis are almost all the corneal diseases with more than 200 micrometer thickness of cornea. Surgical procedure will be shown in case presentation. There are post-operative management of keratoprosthesis. We need only antibiotics after once settled. These are the features of keratoprosthesis. The new concept of keratoprosthesis as an artificial cornea is we can do the transplantation with donor cornea when failed. This is a comparative summary of corneal transplantation, including keratoprosthesis. Now, case presentation. Case one. This is our first keratoprosthesis transplantation. 53-year-old male who had gelatinous drop-like corneal degeneration with two times of previous phototherapeutic keratectomy. His visual acuity was 2300 before operation, and the thickness of cornea was 337 micrometer at the thinnest point. This is the keratoprosthesis transplantation procedure. First, we made a pocket in cornea with femtosecond laser and the peel off the stroma. In this case, we found perforation, but the hole was small, so we continued. After we confirmed that all around the pocket was open, now we inserted the keratoria into this pocket. Then we sutured to stitches. Next day, we found a double chamber, so here's the double chamber, and the anterior chamber was kept deep. Post-operative 3 days, we found subluxation of keratoria and shallow anterior chamber, so we reinserted keratoria and added sutures. After suturing, keratoria stayed stable and his vision improved. Case 2, an 80-year-old male with keratoconus with atopic dermatitis. His visual acuity was 2200 preoperatively, and the thickness of cornea was 349 micrometer at the thinnest point. Keratoria transplantation was similarly performed, and keratoria inserted at 270 micrometer depth because we worried about perforation. His vision was 20/60 on the next day. 4 months after operation, blood vessels invasion and coronary opacity was found, partly because of inflammation of atopic conjunctivitis. After starting tacrolimus, blood vessels saw regression in 2 weeks. Now his visual acuity is 20/60 and inflammation is under control. Case 3. 48-year-old female who had recurrent abernocoronial dystrophy with previous LKP, PKP, and 3 times PTK operation underwent keratoria transplantation. In this case, she had enough thickness of cornea, so we made the pocket a little deeper than keratoria thickness. This is the operation after femtosecond laser cutting. The opacity was very strong, so we need a knife to make a pocket. But the operation was finished smoothly. Visual acuity improved 20/30. Case 4, 47-year-old male who had keratoconus with previous intracoronial rings operation. Before keratoria transplantation, we removed HRS. 3 months later, we inserted keratoria during operation. During operation, this is now we are making the pocket. And during the operation, the inserted keratoria was coming forward. So we made a tight suture, anchoring suture, over keratoria to put back the keratoria. After operation, he had intolerable pain even with medical use contact lens. So we decided to do LKP. We removed the keratoria and tried to perform deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. I was learned dark by Dr. Shimura, so this is like the, what you see yesterday lunch on seminar. But during the operation, perforation of death membrane was found. So we converted to penetrating keratoplasty. So now we cut the, now I cut the death membrane and do the PKP. This is after the PKP. 2 months later, corneal graft was disrupted by trauma. We suggest again, his visual acuity was 20/33. And this case showed that we can perform donor corneal transplantation after cracheal transplantation. This is a summary of 4 cases. All cases improved their visual acuity and about diffraction. Myopia was weakened about 6 diopter in 1 year. Post-operative management of our cases. We can't put off medical use contact lens because of pain. And we continue anti-inflammation, inflammatory eye drops because of inflammation. Conclusion. Cochlear keratoprosthesis is relatively easy and safe procedure. So we need femtosecond laser for this procedure. And it has immediate visual improvement. We think it is a good indication for a non-inflammatory corneal disease like case number 3. After the operation, cochlear tended to be high myopia, but it was weakened about 6 diopters in 1 year. All cases need medical use contact lens after cochlear transplantation. Thank you for your kind attention.
Are there comments or questions on this presentation? Nobody?
I have one question to the senior care surgeons. The type of cases here are relatively low risk for corneal transplantation. Is there a justified role for any keratoprosthetic device when we have the corneal transplantation techniques?
What's been your longest follow-up?
The first case was 3 years, over 3 years.
3 years without so any
complication. But he had also the little inflammation, so we also we once used the tacrolimus to. To control that information.
Okay. Any other questions? So, what was the difference between the case 2 and then case 4 that the causative diseases are same, pretty much same as?
I think the case 4 is more thinner than case 2, and I think that. Cochlea is coming out, so it may be it. I think it is the cause of the pain.
Okay. All right. So thank you, Doctor. So we're going to move on to the next presentation.
Thank you very much.
We call upon Dr. Louis to speak on chondrokeratoprosthesis, an alternative to OOKP.
Thanks to the board who give us this opportunity to expose our experience with chondrokeratoprosthesis. We all know now about the Strompelli device that was invented in 1963, modified by Falcinelli, and nowadays OOKP is still considered as a viable treatment of bilateral end-stage corneal opacification with severe dry eye and high risk of corneal graft rejection. However, the only absolute contraindication are absence of light perception and an edentulous patient. But some questions could arise, especially in young patients where this technique could lead to a mutilating surgery and functional masticatory troubles postoperatively. Moreover, this procedure is not deprived of per and postoperative complication related to the osteodontal complex extraction on the donor sites. Some problem could arise, and we have to propose some solution to this patient. And as we have heard yesterday and this morning, we have to find monoradicular teeth to assemble the keratopathies in this patient. If there are no single root available, it might be possible to obtain a root from a closely related donor, which necessitates systemic immunosuppression and may lead to higher lamina resorption. Another solution could be the Pintucci capro, which use Dacron-Felt for biological integration. However, publication reports inferior results to OKP due to retraction of the mucous membrane and subsequent leakage. Other options include tibial bone allograft, but as we heard, the reported results are still inferior to OKP device, with better functional results at 10 years. Other options will include OKP analogs. There is several development on artificial material that could replace the natural bone in this surgery, but further studies are needed. Conchal cartilage is widely used in maxillofacial surgery with interesting properties as stability, almost no resorption, and resistance to infection. This is why we thought that it could be a good candidate to substitute the osteodontal complex in keratoprosthesis surgery. This is the first step of the procedure after mucosa graft. And you could observe the harvesting technique by posterior approach. This surgery could be done under local anesthesia. A large quantity of cartilage is available. It could be also easily cut to size. And usually we are making a multi-layered sample of cartilage that we suture with polyamide suture. The graft then will be trefined to 3 millimeters, and the cylinder will be pressed into the graft and then secured by cyanoacrylate glue. Then the complex will be implanted into a submuscular pocket as usually in this kind of surgery. Then 3 months later, we'll get the graft back. You could see the large quantity of granular tissue on the device. The buccal mucosa flap is reflected. The eye is trephine. We'll perform a radiodialysis, intracapsular surgery, anterior vitrectomy, as in conventional OKP surgery. Then we will implant the graft by a vicryl suture, and it could be easily managed to suture the graft onto the ocular surface by a transfixion suture. Then the mucosal graft is then reflected and open as usual in front of the optical cylinder. These are results. To this date, only 2 cases were completed. 1 case is waiting for step 2. Our follow-up is a little bit more than 6 months, but despite it is really short, there is no complication to this date. This was the first case. The functional result was not good because the retinal was destroyed by the blast that conduct the patient to blindness. This is the post-operative aspect of the ear. You could see that there's absolutely no sign of the surgery. The second case achieved 2100 Jacob-6. This case was aniridia cases after multiple graft failure. This is the histological aspect of the graft 6 months after retrieval in the submuscular pocket. You could observe the multi-layered graft with the cartilage layer, the pericondylium layer, and the large quantity of connective tissue that develop in the surface of the graft. A closer view where you could see a living cartilage with chondrocytes, and the very important layer is the pericondylium, which consists in two separate layers with an outer fibrous layers and inner chondrogenic layers with fibroblasts, which produce collagenous fibers to regenerate the cartilage layer. There is only a few reports of chondrocartopathies in the literature. The first one was in 1966 by Kaze in London, where he reported the use of costal cartilage to assemble the keratoprosthesis. Another report by Strampelli himself, where he reported in 1967 the use of articular cartilage by the two of the patients. There were no results reported into this publication. So the cartilage pericondylium graft may be an ideal candidate for keratoprosthesis. The advantages of autogenous cartilage include ease of use, availability. This tissue is firm, flexible, can be carved easily. It has a low metabolic rate of metabolism, as osteodontal complex. Its nutrition is done by diffusion, and this is very important at the first days and weeks after the surgery. And it shows a decreased resorption and low infection rates. The most important layer may be the pericondylium. It contains fibroblasts, which produce collagenous fibers, and can form chondroblasts on chondrocytes that could regenerate the graft. And the new regeneration will be performed by appositional graft. In conclusion, the OKP remains the keratoprosthesis of choice for end-stage corneal blindness, but dental tissue-related complication and availability could be an issue. The use of cartilage conchal cartilage and pericondylium may be an efficient alternative, but for sure, further follow-up is needed for this technique to be evaluated. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Louis. Do we have any questions?
Good morning, my name is Laurent Guyot, I am maxillofacial surgeon. I am used to work with Professor Louis Offar, and I am used to harvesting bone and cartilage graft, and we use for maxillary reconstruction cranial bone. But in my opinion, bone is good to replace bone. So we tibial bone or ivot tibial iliac crest or calvaria bone graft can be used in maxillary or in bone, but maybe it's not very good graft for support of a prosthesis. So cranial bone graft has a less rate of resorption than iliac crest because of embryogenic conditions. It's a membranous bone, and tibial bone and iliac crest bone are from chondrogenic origin.
Thank you. We've always looked at the option of cartilage because, like you rightly mentioned, one, it is by virtue of its low metabolic rate, the issue of resorption is probably less with cartilage than in bone. The only issue of concern here is the way in which the cylinder has been integrated to the cartilage is using cyanoacrylate glue. So do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, the main problem issue is that there is no cement or no glue as usually used in the OOKP for etanchéité of the disposal. But one of the advantages of this tissue is that there is almost no resorption, and to this date there was no sign of endophthalmitis or any other complication like leakage in our patient, but for sure the six-month follow-up is really short, so we need time to evaluate more accurately this device.
Yeah, thank you. So we move on to the next presentation, if I'm pronouncing it right, Dr. Paschalis, micropressure sensor integrated into the Boston keratoprosthesis.
Hello, I would like to thank the organizers for having us here. It's been a pleasure being in Japan, first time, even though I missed the karaoke yesterday. So, yes, the title of my presentation is a micropressure sensor which is integrated into the CAPRO, and that includes, that can be applied to any kind of CAPRO. So my disclosure, I'm a full-time employee at Mass Eye and Ear Infirmary, and we have filed a patent for that. So glaucoma is one of the most important irreversible complications in CAPRO, and perhaps the most important of all the complications that we have, because as Dr. Dolman says, we can correct the cornea, but we can never correct the retina. So it affects long-term vision and success of CAPRO, and this has been shown by multiple studies, including recent studies by study by our group, where CAPRO patients that had no glaucoma prior to CAPRO implantation developed glaucoma. And the most important was that this type of glaucoma was extraordinary, 7.5 times faster progression compared to primary open angle glaucoma. So what is glaucoma? It's a multifactorial disease characterized by progressive visual loss and a reduction in the nerve fiber layer and RGCs. And what causes glaucoma? There are many factors. The most important are intraocular pressure elevation, inflammation, deprivation of neurotrophins, and genetic factors. But regardless of the etiology and the mechanism, IOP still is the only solution that we have as far as therapeutic is concerned. It has been proven that it's the only neuroprotective therapy we have right now for glaucoma. So how do we measure IOP? We measure, I mean, the gold standard is the Goldman, but in a CAPRO patient, this is not possible, and we often use our fingers, which is not reliable, and many times we underestimate the pressure. And there has been several attempts. The most recent successful attempt was the implantation of a MEMS, which is based on a coil antenna. It's an IOL type of sensor, and that is produced by implant data. And the whole principle is that it uses a capacitive transducer that one membrane deflects upon pressure, and you're measuring the change in the capacitance, and that gives you the pressure. So this device was actually implanted in humans. There is an extra surgery that you need to perform, or at least there is an extra implant that you have to put, even if you do it together with a CAPRO. So if you see now the long-term results published by Melki, you will see that there is a significant drift, and you can see it here. A significant drift by week 76. And one can wonder what can happen a lot later. So if we had to summarize telemetry, we will say that it has an advantage because it provides IOP measurements on demand. It's not affected by corneal biomechanics, but it suffers from IOP drift, and this is an inherent problem of MEMS, of the sensor itself. Requires surgical implantation in addition to the CAPRO. It's incompatible with electromagnetic fields and MRI, and can cause complications, including glaucoma. So there is a clear need for an integrated solution for the CAPRO. And we have been working over the last year on a new type of sensor that we integrated into the CAPRO in the peripheral optical part. And this is based on MOMS, not MEMS, MOMS. This is micro-optomechanical sensor. And because we're using an optical sensor, we can shrink down everything. So we have put this into a 305 micrometers tunnel hole at the periphery of the CAPRO. And the interrogation, this is a schematic representation, can happen using a fiber optic cable, which can be mounted on a slit lamp and connected to a computer. So this sensor has the same property, the same principle. Still, there is a membrane that deflects. But because we're using such a high frequency modulation, which is the light, we can detect deformations down to the angstrom. So below nanometer. That means that we don't need to deform too much and we don't cause permanent stresses or permanent changes within the membrane. And that reduces significantly the drift. And the principle of operation is by constructive or destructive interference. You have two semi-reflective mirrors within the cavity. You shine a light from a computer, the light goes in, it bounces back and forth into the mirrors, and only one wavelength will be amplified, and this wavelength it depends on the distance between the two mirrors, the cavity distance. So you detect this change, this shift in the wavelength, and this is correlated then to pressure. So before we start really using this sensor, we need to make sure that this sensor does not exhibit drift, and it's reliable. So we set up an experiment for in vitro experiment to test it for 1 year. So we used two pre-calibrated sensors in order to check if there is a difference between them. And we submerged them in a column that generated a pressure of 90 millimeters of mercury. Measurements were performed. Right now it's 10 months, but the endpoint is 12 months. And we perform one sample per minute, and this is one sample per minute for 10 months. And we simultaneously measure the barometric pressure because that affects the overall pressure. So this is the 10-month result. This is channel one, meaning the first pressure sensor. You can see that there is a fluctuation in the pressure, which is basically the fluctuation in the atmospheric pressure. And if you overlay the second sensor, you can see that they overlap, and they overlap exactly. The range that we measured, it's from minus 7 to plus 40, which is a good range, and this is a more realistic assessment compared to other attempts to study drift, where you have a steady pressure, a continuous pressure that doesn't change. So you're not really measuring the dynamic changes of the membrane. Now, if you add in the atmospheric pressure, this is the atmospheric pressure, and if you factor in the hydrostatic pressure that we are creating, which is 19 millimeters of mercury, there is a complete correlation of the data, and this is a 10-month data. Looking now and zooming into the data, in a very small part, which is a 3 days data or a 2 days data, you can see that the red and the black, which are the two sensors, they overlap, and this is at 10 months. That shows that there's a good correlation between the sensors. There is a very, very minimal drift. And the most important is that how do we measure? So we need to perform some kind of a non-contact or minimally contact measurement. So we attempted to perform measurements at a distance. The maximum distance we could perform, you can see there is one sensor. This is a fiber optic sensor, and this is a second fiber optic sensor here. Sorry, this is the fiber optic unit, the interrogation fiber optic unit, and this is the sensor. We were able to achieve a 360 micrometer separation distance and still get a good signal-to-noise ratio to be able to determine pressure. When we added a water interface, we were able to increase this to 560. And we were able also to measure even at misalignment up to a 20 degrees angle. So pros and cons, it is a reliable modality to measure pressure. It has a very good accuracy within plus minus 0.2 millimeters of mercury. We have a less than 1 millimeter of mercury drift within 10 months, and it doesn't seem, to tell you the truth, it doesn't seem to change. The results are reproducible. It is MRI compatible, which is very, very important. There are no electrons, there are no metals inside the sensor. The fabrication is performed using biocompatible materials. Does not require an extra surgery, so it doesn't create any extra complications. Even if it fails, it just stays there without causing any ill effects. And it has a very low cost. One of the disadvantages is that it cannot perform telemetric measurements, meaning that being home and basically measuring the pressure wirelessly. So, but that might not be a significant problem because you can treat these patients as you treat the open angle glaucoma patients, regular visits, IOP measurements, and then adjusting them medication. So the next steps, we are currently in the process of to integrate it fully in the CAPRO, and we're going to perform animal tests. And given that we have good success with the animals, we're going to move forward to a small pilot human study. I would like to thank here Dr. Dolman and Dr. Chodos, my mentors and my collaborators. And I would like to pass the greetings from Dr. Dolman. He said to give to everyone here his hi. He couldn't come, but he's really, really happy that we are here and discussing about CAPROS. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that presentation. Do we have any questions? Yes.
Is there any chance that it could clog up because of its size and aqueous proteins and so on?
So the sensor itself is protected. There is a polyamide sheathing, and in front of the sensor there is a gel. So even if there is kind of a protein deposits, they will not directly contact the membrane. Still, they might form a barrier, but because the pressure changes are relatively slow, they don't change within a minute, eventually there's going to be equilibrium of pressure, so you're going to be able to measure it. Now, in case there is an issue, we are thinking of actually putting two sensors within one CAPRO, using one for measurements and the other one as a backup. And that could also serve better for measuring drift very long term without needing to do intracameral measurements.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we move on to the next talk by Dr. Venkat Avadanam on hydrogel skirt for synthetic OOKP lamina.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about some of the experiments we have been doing to develop synthetic keratoprosthetic lamina, which is more towards the OOKP procedure. I presented some part of the study in previous conferences, so I have more data. As you know, there is the current OOKP technique involves extraction of the tooth and preparation of the lamina and incorporation of the cylinder, optical cylinder, which is made of polymethyl methacrylate, and then the device is implanted into the eye. It's a two-stage procedure, and you can see the mucous membrane covering, which just covers the device, and only the optical portion you can see. And if you go back to the history, there's quite a lot to learn, and we are still, we have lots of experiments done with the many devices. The main problem is developing this skirt, which is not only biointegrable, it is also bioretainable. That's the problem. Like the pure hydroxyapatite has been tried, and we know the titanium, and this is a Dacron mesh, and Alphacar. This is actually a hydrogel, but each of these devices have a different way of implantation. The previous hydrogel work was done on alpha carb, which is a polyhema, but it was incorporated intralamellar, similar to the, what we have seen as a Keroclear, but this device did not work well. Anyway, so now I'm presenting another kind of a hydrogel material, which is actually an interpenetrating network. So where is the need for it? The OVKP is working fine, but we have lots of problems with the current OVKP, which has been trying to be addressed for a number of years. So I'm sure that the synthetic analog can solve this problem. So, but we have the challenges. So are we trying to establish a similar model for a bone skirt similar to a bone, or we can go for get away with a different one? But anyway, we try to look at the properties of the bone, why this biological haptic is successful. Because of sporosity, that means the cells can migrate and live happily. And mineralization, that is a sign that, that becomes an added mechanical strength to this thing. And also, it more adherence to the cylinder to that. Because both are rigid. PMMJ is an inflexible, rigid piece of plastic. And it is mechanically, it can be more easily fixed into a rigid structure like bone. So we are trying to look at the hydrogel properties in a way we can match this. It is biocompatible, hypermeable, and it is quite a bit of chemical diversity. So we have perhaps a very wide range of polymers available, and it can be fabricated into any shape that we want. But it has some disadvantages, low mechanical strength and low cell adhesiveness. But we overcome with our these drawbacks in our study. So basically, coming back to what is a interpenetrating network. In the interpenetrating network, it's actually a group, it's a polymer network. Polymer means it's a number of monomers, a large number of monomers are linked, interlinked together by chemical bonds. So in here, in a penetrating network, one network A is there, and we incorporate another network there. So basically, it increases the stiffness and adds to the two properties. But they do not cancel out each other. So in this experiment, we have used a biological network, which is a molecule made of agarose, and there is a synthetic ductile network, which is polyethylene glycolic dicrylate acid. So both are incorporated, and we looked at the properties and studies. So the agarose is available in natural tissues as well, this polymer. So it, which is prepared, this disc of polymer, agarose discs are prepared by heating the solution, and then they are soaked in a PEG-DA solution, and then this old composite is cross-linked in a way similar to collagen cross-linking under ultraviolet rays. And then it forms a quite solid scaffold. So we use this method, which is also patented and published before. So we cut out the discs, and then we send them for culture, and then we did a range of tests. And one other area is we also incorporated a hydroxyapatite into this material to see whether it can improve the biocompatibility. I cannot go through lots of details here, but the preparation of the hydroxyapatite is a complex process where there's a polylactococoglycolic acid, which is another polymer, which is, forms microspheres. We can only see under electron microscope. Those spheres are coated with the hydroxyapatite, and these spheres are embedded into the material. And we studied under electron microscope, and we coated them under simulated body fluid because that's the body has a tendency to biomineralize any implants. And we confirmed an EDAX analysis, which is basically a way of looking at the deposition of the minerals inside any material. The calcium phosphate composition is almost equal to that of a bone. So these are electronic microscopes. We can see that each evenly coated all over the microspheres. And we also looked at the swelling properties. Swelling properties for any hydrogel polymers is basically how much water it retains. So it is an indirect way of measuring how biocompatible it is. Are the cells going to live in it with the exchange of fluid? So we looked at it. And for this experiment, we have made different compositions of the polymer because the mechanical strength improves the more stronger the concentrate of the polymer in it. So the one, and also we looked at hydroxyapatite incorporated polymers in both ways. We found that the here it is the 5% agarose with the 40% high concentration, which gives us enough mechanical strength as well as the swelling properties. We looked at the mechanical strength. This is IPN network, 540 IPN network, 5% agarose, 40% PEG-DA with hydroxyapatite incorporation gives our highest strength that we require. And then we did this cell studies, including the fibroblasts and keratocytes on the range of the composites we prepared. We looked at the porosity. Actually, the agarose has a good porosity. It is a low magnification, and even the IPN has a less size of the pores, but it is enough. It's almost 100 microns. Easily, a colony of cells can survive. And also one more study we did is we seeded the cells, fibroblasts and keratocytes, inside the material and then tested for cell growth and viability. It's a three-dimensional analysis. This is how, in a standard plate, we just seed the cells and see how they grow. And this is the material we seeded onto the top of the material. And in three-dimensional culture, we actually implanted the cells into the material. And this is the fibroblast. So you can see the test plate. So that gives us a comparison against which. And we used control as a polymethyl methacrylate, which is used as the optical cylinder. So we know that these cells grow everywhere in all the material, but not on the PMMA, as we know that it is inert. So it is biocompatible. And then this is the three-dimensional structures. Actually, the cells are inside the material, these fibroblasts. They're also forming quite nice colonies. And you can see very few red, which means dead. And keratocytes, they also follow the same, similar to the fibroblasts, and they grow very well on a range of materials, and even hydroxyapatite worked a bit more to influence this. And it is again a three-dimensional analysis. You can see the cells has a tendency to focus upon the hydroxyapatite crystals. That we have another study I'm not presenting here, that we are looking at how the hydroxyapatite is attracting the cells. And then cytokine production. This is to see what the inflammatory properties of this material. So these cells have been compared with the lipopolysaccharide, which is actually an inflammatory material. If we induce, the cells are producing more cytokines. So we use that as a benchmark and compare. So the range of materials is almost are equal. And this is our candidate material, which is less inflammatory. And also the keratocytes also behave the same property like the fibroblasts. And in summary, I think the hydrogels has the potential to serve as a synthetic OOKP analog. And the main advantage is we can control the strength of the material as well as the mold, the shape of the material very well. And we can increase the cell adhesiveness by incorporating a variety of materials, so like hydroxyapatite, or some people can try different protein coatings as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Venkat. Any questions?
Yes. If you could explain your question, is the dispersion of these microspheres. There are microspheres. That's diameters are at the level of very, very micron size. So I don't think there would be an issue there. They are forming as a clusters. And then, because it is only in vitro experiment, there are lots of impurities in preparing the material. So I think you can spread the concentration of them where you want the cells to be. Intelligently, you can place them. So it is only the basic study is can we make the incorporation and then we sell, do they actually work against the cell viability? So we found that it is compatible, we can do this. It is only just a prototype, it's a first study. I think your question is valid, and we are looking at where we can place the cells, the spears, where we want the cell growth. It is possible.
I'm Dr. Minami from University of Tokyo. I saw that nanohydrox apatite had a role to invite cells. But in vivo, do you think, is there a possibility that the hydrox apatite will be absorbed?
Yes, very good question. Our main intention is to make the cells to go into the material and are they livable. So the basic property of the material, porosity, and the ability to retain water is going to determine. In the first, initially, we want the material to be incorporated, integrated. So once the cells go in, and they are there, they produce their own hydroxyapatite in that they make it stiffer. And then the beauty of this is, these devices, for any reason, if the device fails, it is available off the shelf, like Boston Caprol, and we can just exchange it. So the purpose of the hydroxyapatite is temporary. They will dissolve over a period of months.
Thank you.
I think I would invite Geeta to do the next presentation. Can I have that one just to see?
After those two interesting talks on micropressure sensor and what the future could offer in terms of a synthetic analog of OOKP, I will be talking about trauma after OOKP. We have had a few patients who have come back to us with trauma following the OOKP procedure. And there are a few points that are different in these. In eyes that have undergone the OOKP. So basically, these are patients who have a reduced field of vision. And the more common form of trauma that we see is a mechanical trauma. We have had one patient who actually presented to us with a very vague history of chemical injury following the procedure. And any trauma basically leads to an impact on the optic-haptic junction, and this could lead to a cylinder mobility. There's also the possibility of an increased resorption of the lamina following the trauma itself or the surgical intervention that is done following the trauma for the presentation that the patient comes with. And definitely there are many intraoperative challenges in an eye that has undergone the OOKP procedure when they come back with a trauma. So this was a 38-year-old lady who'd undergone the OOKP procedure in 2006 following Stevens-Johnson syndrome. This was her only seeing eye. She regained a vision of 6/6 in that eye. She came back, she maintained a vision of 6/6 for 5 years. For some reason, she decided to put in something into the eye to make her probably to improve the cosmesis at the advice of some acquaintance, and this is what happened after she used the substance. There was a mucosal necrosis of the inferior mucosa, and someone had tried to appose and suture the two ends of the mucosa locally where she stays. I don't know if that was the reason, but she presented to us with a corneal perforation below this lamina. The superior mucosa was very healthy, and she had hypotony. There was choroidal detachment, but her perception to light was brisk. This was the only eye that we were dealing with, so we had to do everything to try and salvage what we had. So this was a slightly different situation where we had to reflect the mucosa from below up and reflected it supranasally. We removed the lamina. The lamina was noted to be intact, and so it with no mobility of the cylinder, and it was placed back in the contralateral pouch subsequently after we finished the ocular surgery. It was a hypotonous globe. We went ahead with a tectonic penetrating keratoplasty, and the mucosa was reflected back. So at least anatomically, the globe had been salvaged. And postoperatively, in the area where the chemical had interacted with the ocular surface, there was problem with, we had mucosal issues. We had to take her up for multiple revision procedures, top up the mucosa. And this was a bucket handle flap, then fresh mucosa below. This was how she looked, but we were concerned about this area where you can see that there's a slight pull on the mucosa. And we placed back, we required almost 9 to 10 months of mucosal revision procedures before we could take her up for re-implanting the lamina in the eye. And just as we had expected, there was this area that had mucosal necrosis and exposure of the lamina, for which we did a tarsal conjunctival pedicle flap, and she actually regained back a vision of 6/6 to our surprise, and maintained a vision of 6/6 for 3 years following the trauma that she came back to us with a healthy disc. We anticipated, I mean, normally we tend to anticipate a lot of complications, but this, her pressures were okay, her disc was healthy after the way she presented. There was no spike in her intraocular pressure, and she came back regularly for follow-ups after this. And unfortunately, 3 years later, she came back with a mechanical trauma to the eye, presented 2 weeks after a drop in vision in her eye. And she had a retinal detachment, but unfortunately this time it was an inoperable retinal detachment and the surgery had to be abandoned. We were able to maintain a vision of 6/6 for her over a period of 8 years with an episode of a vague chemical injury to the eye. But unfortunately we lost the eye subsequently to another episode of trauma. Two patients, again, post-chemical injury, who had trauma to the eye, and they presented to us with a leak. This patient underwent the procedure in 2006, came in 2008 with a trauma, and he required a re-tooth to be prepared, got back a vision of 6/9, which was maintained for a period of 3 years. But for some reason, after that, he developed this cyst superiorly beneath the mucosa, which we noted intraoperatively to have really no communication with the globe, but it kept refilling. We did multiple measures to excise the cyst. And we went ahead with the scleral patch graft and a drainage tube. The cyst sort of settled, but whether it was related to the trauma or the multiple intraocular procedures that he had undergone because of a replacement of the lamina, he had a shallow retinal detachment, and then subsequently he did not come back to us for a follow-up for any further intervention in this eye. This was another young teacher, actually a school teacher, and we went ahead with the OOKP in one eye. He was another patient who hit his head against the door and it hit the eye. He had advanced glaucomatous cupping. He had a tube in the eye. He was maintaining a vision of 6/9 in that eye, and then had the trauma 3 years after the primary OKP surgery was done. This was a patient when we opened up, the lamina was intact, but the opening around the lamina, it looked like we had to replace it with a slightly larger cylinder, which we ordered for, placed the lamina in the pouch, and then when we got the new cylinder 2 weeks later, we re-cemented the cylinder and then put it back into the eye. This is what I was mentioning yesterday, that we didn't actually put it back into the pouch. I do understand that there are concerns of the monomer following the polymerization of the glue getting into the eye if you do it in the same step, but we've been following up this patient for a couple of years after that, and we did not have any intraocular inflammation that we noticed after having done the same. However, there was a continued resorption of the cylinder, which is what I was mentioning, that whether it is a trauma-related increase in the resorption or a surgical manipulation-related resorption. But the lamina continued to resorb, and he came back with a leak 1 year later. Now, this patient underwent the OKP surgery at a time that we were not doing the Boston type 1 keratoprosthesis. And this was, we're already, I think both his upper canines had been harvested the first time because the first canine was found unsuitable for implantation. And he was a little reluctant to go ahead with another tooth at this point in time. We had no other option, and we tried to see if we could actually remove the keratoprosthesis and do a Boston type 1 in this patient after reconstructing the surface with amniotic membrane and after the surface epithelized following the removal of the keratoprosthesis. And actually this was a patient who, following the type 1 keratoprosthesis, maintained continued to maintain a vision of 6-9, and then a year later, I mean, we did have issues related to blink. He underwent a tarsorrhaphy and some amount of exposure, and he did develop a year later, we had he came back to us with a severe vitritis for which the capro was finally removed. And this was actually the time that we realized that there was a need for a keratoprosthesis to be designed to be used beneath the mucosa in these kind of eyes where we've done the OKP, where we would face a situation where we would have to replace it with another keratoprosthesis. And this is how the discussions began, and we came up with the idea of using the Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis in these patients. This is our only patient with bilateral OKP, chemical injury, glaucoma in both the eyes, two AMID glaucoma valves done in the superotemporal quadrant. He's maintaining a vision of 6-9 in both the eyes, though he has a significantly reduced field of vision. His pressures were always on the borderline despite being on systemic acetazolamide, and he underwent a second AGV in both the eyes in the year 2013 in a gap of 6 months. After that, he came back with a trauma again. He hit his hit himself against a glass door in a restaurant, and he came back where we noted that the cylinder was mobile. So we took him up for removed the lamina, but here all we needed to do was re-cement because it was just a loosening of the cylinder. There was no enlargement of trephined area in the lamina. So we re-cemented it and re-implanted it, and I just saw him last month. It's now 18 months following the re-implantation. He has two tubes in both his eyes. Pressures are relatively under control, and he still continues to maintain a vision of 6-9 in both his eyes, now 11 years down following the primary OKP procedure. So these were just a few patients that I wanted to share who've had different forms of trauma. In fact, these were some of the patients who added on to our series of lamina resorption that we have had in our patients. So I don't know if we could really call them as lamina resorption or whether it was because of the trauma-induced changes in the lamina. And trauma in OKP is slightly different from the other capros. We have multiple components in the eye, and they have to be addressed in order to try and salvage the eye. And we sometimes do look at a stopgap arrangement before we can actually harvest the next tooth so that the patient continues to see, because like someone mentioned earlier in one of the talks about dealing with second blindness, you sometimes want to keep them visually going till you have done something more definitive, which is where we started doing the Lucia type 2 keratoprosthesis as a stopgap arrangement in some of these patients. Thank you.
Time for just one question.
Chris, have you had any such experience with trauma following Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to conclude this session. So next session, we'll start 2 minutes time.